Welcome to the finance meeting for Monday, April 4th. Madam Clerk, please read item number one.
Appointment Wayne A. Lake, Brockton, as a constable in the city of Brockton for a term of 3 years, invited Wayne A. Lake.
Mr. Lake, you can step right up to the rostrum. Just give us your name for the record.
Wayne A. Lake.
Questions?
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you, Mr. Lake.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, make a motion to move number 10.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to take item number 10 out of order. All those in favor? Opposed? Madam Clerk, please read item number 10.
Order appropriation of $142,947 from Executive Office of Elder Affairs Grant 142947 to Brockton Council on Aging, Executive Office of Elder Affairs Grant Fund, invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Janice Fitzgerald, Director.
Good evening. Have all your charges recovered from the council courts?
Yes. My ears are still ringing, but that's okay.
Could you tell us what this grant is and what you'll be doing with it?
So this is a yearly award from the Executive Office of Elder Affairs. It's a formula grant. This year, the formula was raised to $9 per elder. We continue to fight every year to get that number increased. We're hoping for next year to be at $10 per elder. And for the new councilors here, we have over 15,000 people in Brockton, 60 and older, so...
60's not old.
No, and older.
Being one of them, I'd like to make a comment. Your staff, your volunteers do a wonderful job. I have a chance to attend many, many functions, and all the people enjoy themselves, and it's thanked. With that, I'd like to make a motion for approval.
Second.
Full council.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? So moved.
Mr. Chairman?
Thank you.
If I may ask, can I make a motion to move number 18 out of order?
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion made and seconded to take item number 18 out of order. All those in favor?
Oh, sure, that makes sense, yeah.
Opposed? Madam Clerk, please read number 18.
Resolve that Eval Savara or his designee be invited to appear before a committee of the city council to update council members on the Code Connect program, whose mission is to expose and teach kids age 8 to 13 years old computer programming, or coding for short, in the community. Invited Eval Savara.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
How are you?
If I could just if I could...
Counselor Barnes.
Yes, if I could just maybe mention how this got on. I've known Eval actually and his wife for my entire life, and his beautiful kids are here. And he has been trying to start a program to enrich young girls, young boys in learning how to program. We are definitely in a global, we want to be globally competitive with education and to make sure that our kids are prepared to go forward and to be qualified for the next wave of jobs. It's no longer okay to just have a high school diploma or a master's degree even. You have to have these special skill sets. So he was very passionate about wanting to start a coding program for kids in the city. And it's either, I'm not sure if it's started yet. I think it's right on the verge of getting started. But he's worked very, very hard with several of the library staff and getting kids involved. And I believe he has a demonstration here with his kids. So I'm just going to let him just talk about his program.
Thank you, Shanna. We're ecstatic and excited about this. I have two kids, as you can see. My son Joseph, who's 7 years old, and my daughter Tamia, who's 10 years old. And our focus is in the kindergarten through fifth grade space. I've done some conversations and presentations with a few of the current programs that are available right now. Youth Career Connect, I went and spoke with some of the high school students. And it's interesting that they're not yet understanding what sort of the availability is for programming and coding and the types of opportunities that those bring. So part of my program is to actually build a bridge, build a pipeline for some of these kids to actually be exposed to these types of programs. And so as they go into those other programs that are in the high school space, they can be prepared. There's a stat right now, I think 2010 from the Labor Department. By 2020, there's about 1.4 million jobs that will be available for programming. Only 400,000 of those will be actually filled, so there'll be a gap of about 1 million jobs in the coding and programming space. We're trying to prepare these kids, and they're excited. So what I wanted to do is, do you guys all set? I wanted to kind of give you guys a quick demo of the types of things that we're doing. Our first programming class is during April vacation. We've partnered up with the Brockton Public Library. We'll be doing that from about 3 to 5 every day that week, and we're going to teach them Blockly with Dash and Dot. Now, this is actually Dash is a movable robot, and Dot right here is an actual another robot that doesn't move, and the kids actually want to give a quick demonstration. Come up here. We've created an alarm system based on Dot being an actual quote-unquote diamond and Dash being sort of the alarm system. So if the
And I do want to say, too, Yvonne and his wife, they are Brockton residents.
Yeah. Okay, so you're ready? All right. So the object of this is if the Dot moves, the diamond. Okay, hold on. There you go.
Is it moving?
So the kids actually programmed that, if you can show. So we use visual programming, so you can see some of these blocks. The kids learn about how to set, build certain instructions to the robots, and the robots will interact with those instructions, and that's how we computer code. So we're going to be teaching a lot of these kids some really awesome, yeah, you can turn it off, some really awesome new types of programming skills, and we're going to set them straight and get them on the right path to take advantage of these awesome and lucrative jobs that are available in the near future. Thank you very much.
So how can people reach you or to enroll their kids? What's the process for that?
Thank you. CodeConnect.org is the website, K-O-D-E, Connect, C-O-N-N-C-T.org. CodeConnect.
C-O-N-N-E-C-T?
C-O-N-N-E-C-T. I must have missed
.org. That one. Okay, great. And all right, that's really great. And I'll give it up to my counselor colleagues if you have any questions.
Counselor Farwell.
Sir, I'm always humbled by the fact that young people are so technologically gifted. So it's a great program. It is the wave of the future. And for those of us who need to get up to speed, at least to compete with your children, we'll keep trying. So.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Any other questions?
Councilor Farwell still has a rotary phone at home.
If there are no further questions, I'll move to recommend this favorably.
Second.
Thank you.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably. All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you very much, and good luck with the program. And thank you, kids. Great presentation.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Rodriguez.
If I could, I'd like to move item 13 and take it out of order.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to take item number 13 out of order. All those in favor? Opposed? So moved. Madam Clerk, would you read item number 13, please?
Resolved to have members of One Smile Brockton Coalition come before a committee of the Brockton City Council to discuss the efforts and accomplishments of the coalition with regards to the introduction of water fluoridation program in the city of Brockton, invited Louis E. Tartaglia, Jr., Executive Director, Board of Health, Dr. John Fisher, fluoride expert, Dr. Mary Jane Dolan, community dentist, Maria Mendez.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Rodriguez.
Mr. Chairman, I filed this resolve because being a Brockton resident and being here, living in this city for quite some time, getting a little long on the tooth.
Is that a pun?
Yeah, it was. We've always had a problem with the lack of fluoride in the water here in the city of Brockton, and we've had quite a few people working on bringing fluoride to the city of Brockton, and I appreciate the work of Maria and the coalition and all the work that Lou Tartaglia has actually done in terms of bringing this to the attention of residents and city officials as well. So I'm going to let them do a little presentation of some of the issues that they have to talk about. And then we'll go from there and open it up to the other councils.
You can step forward and give us your name.
I am Maria Mendez Mumbler.
Thank you. And if you want to give us a little background on the program.
Sure. So I am the campaign organizer for One Smile Brockton, and I'm also a lifelong resident of this city where I live with my husband and my two young children. And I'm here to ask everyone for your support as we seek to get the city of Brockton's water fluoridated. First, I would like to thank everyone for inviting One Smile Brockton to speak today. And we essentially, we are a community-based group of water fluoridation advocates that strongly support, we are strongly supported by many local organizations and residents who are very committed and passionate about this issue. One Smile Brockton, we are an initiative of the Greater Brockton Health Alliance, formerly known as Community Health Network Area, previously known as CHNA 22. And our goal, again, is to bring water fluoridation to our city to improve the health, the overall health of our community. Our diverse group of community champions consists of well-known and dedicated dentists, pediatricians, parents, educators, community leaders who are all committed to making Brockton as healthy and vibrant as possible. These leaders have been instrumental in reaching out, educating, and building support for community water fluoridation. Our campaign began back in May of 2014, and since that time, we have been able to gather thousands of support from residents through signature pledge cards, as well as community organizational support letters. And we've been able to get the support of many, many organizations, including the Brockton Public Schools, Brockton Housing Authority, the Cape Verdean Association of Brockton, South Shore Haitians United for Progress, and the list goes on. I have the banner with me there that I wanted to bring just to highlight the different messages and signatures that we've been able to collect from residents really advocating and asking us to get the city fluoridated. I also have with me, which I didn't bring up, but it's back there, a stack of pledge cards that we took these to community events for residents to be able to show their support. And those are the pledge cards from the shy ones that did not want their pictures on the website. If you visit onesmallbrockton.org, you'll see that we have thousands of signatures already there. The residents of Brockton want their water fluoridated. They already know the health benefits. In fact, when we started this process, we learned that residents were aware of water fluoridation. They knew the benefits. They supported our efforts. And others didn't know about the benefits. We were able to educate them. And we were even able to speak with some residents that thought that City of Brockton's water had been fluoridated. And they were under the impression that it's been fluoridated for some time now. As some of you might know, back in 1972, the Brockton Board of Health was ordered to fluoridate the community, and it was unfortunately never implemented. In fact, we learned that it reached, I think it failed to actually reach the council, and this time we are determined to see it through. We were lucky to be able to get the full support of the Brockton Board of Health on Tuesday, April 2nd. They unanimously voted to approve community water fluoridation and to send us to the council. Community water fluoridation, it's a proven, safe, and cost-effective way to promote stronger teeth for everyone, regardless of your age, your income, your race, your access to dental care, which you will have the opportunity to hear more about from a doctor that we have here with us from the Brockton Neighborhood Health Center. In fact, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the CDC, calls community water fluoridation one of the top 10 greatest public health achievements of the 20th century, and it is supported by every major public health, medical, and scientific organization. They have all endorsed community water fluoridation. Now I bet everyone's thinking, this is great. Now how much is this going to cost? First, there's a startup cost that can range from anywhere from $40,000 to $60,000 for cities the size of Brockton. And depending on the water system and other aspects that can better be explained by an engineer, we would be able to get a better, more accurate sense of numbers. One Smile Brockton is confident that this startup cost, whatever this number is, it will be covered by the Massachusetts Department of Public Health. They are fully supportive of our efforts of community water fluoridation and historically have covered the initial costs. Ongoing costs to maintain fluoridated water are very minimal. They range from cents to about a dollar per resident per year. However, until we are able to fully understand the system that Brockton has and get an engineer's perspective on the equipment's readiness and other factors, we will not be able to know the exact costs. So what I'm asking of you today is I'm asking for you to approve community water fluoridation for the city of Brockton contingent on the startup costs being covered. So essentially, if the startup costs are not covered, then we will not move forward to get the city of Brockton's water fluoridated. However, since we are very confident on whatever this number it is being covered by the Massachusetts Department of Public Health, we are asking for your support today. So what I would like to do next is invite Dr. Marie Jane Dolan from the Brockton Neighborhood Health Center to really help us put all this into perspective on how this ties into the city of Brockton, to how this impacts our children, our community, and how we can really help to make a difference and make Brockton a healthier community for everyone that lives here.
Thank you. Dr. Dolan, you want to step right up?
So my name is Dr. Jane Marie Dolan, so that's all right. And I am a pediatrician at the Brockton Neighborhood Health Center as well as the assistant medical director there. I just want to give you a little background on fluoride. I don't want to get too technical, and then I just want to talk about the impact on our community and on our children and what I see, what I've seen over the last 11 years as I've worked in the health center. As many of you know, fluoride is a natural cavity fighter. It protects teeth, both given systemically and topically. So systemic fluorides are ones that are ingested through the body. So that's the drops, the tablets we give, and also through the fluorinated water. This gets incorporated in what we call the pre-eruptive dental structures, which are the teeth that are forming. So fluoride given in infancy and early childhood, when the teeth are forming, these teeth have stronger enamel and have longer lasting protection against decay and dental caries than teeth that just received topical fluoride. Topical fluoride is the fluoride we see in toothpaste that we put on varnishes as well as rinses. And fluorinated water not only acts as a systemic protectant, but as a topical agent because it does, the saliva soaks the teeth and gives it even more protection. So, as Maria said, community water fluoridation has been recommended for a long time, and the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services stated that community water fluoridation is the most cost-effective, practical, and safe means for reducing the occurrence of dental decay in the community. It reduces the rate of cavities in baby teeth by as much as 60%, and in adult teeth by as much as 35%. Also, when you compare fluorinated and non-fluorinated communities, this cost is savings and a treatment of like a Medicaid-eligible preschooler is about $36 per child in communities with water fluorination. There have been a number of studies over the last 70 years since water fluorination has been introduced, and the studies show that it is safe and beneficial to everyone, regardless of age and socioeconomic status, but definitely has a greater impact in poorer communities. As a pediatrician, dental caries is definitely a particular concern because dental caries is actually the number one disease in children, 5 times more common than asthma. Dental caries and decay is seen in all age groups, even into adulthood, but it's a big issue in children's health. Children with dental decay and caries often have pain, miss a lot of school, often due to visits to the dentist and the doctors. This really affects our parents here because many of our parents are single parents and miss work for multiple visits. It can affect speech development in children because a lot of their children's baby teeth get pulled and their speech, they need extra help with school. It also affects nutrition. So children with severe dental caries can be both overweight or underweight because they can't chew the proper foods for good nutrition. I have seen children with decay starting as early as 1 year of age. I have dozens and dozens of toddlers who've had their teeth pulled because of dental caries in Brockton. Just today, a typical day for me in my office, new teenager, multiple dental caries, already been seen by the dentist twice. 2 teens with caries. I had a 7-year-old today who had 8 crowns in his mouth and has had teeth extracted when he was a young child, even younger, like 3 or 4 years of age. As many of you know, there are other reasons for dental caries, includes not just fluoride exposure, but lower socioeconomic status, patients who are particularly on MassHealth or Medicaid, mothers with active disease can, by germs, can spread this to their children, and then poor diet. As many of you know, the poverty rate in Brockton is about 15%, and almost 20% of our children live below the poverty level. There is a problem with dental caries in the Black and Hispanic population, which is much higher rate of tooth loss than in white adults. Many of the parents I see have dental decay, and this affects their child's dental health. And even though we start fluoride supplementation at 6 months of age and really give a lot of education regarding dental care, many of our children require extensive dental work. The latest data on oral health in Massachusetts shows that Brockton has the highest rate of dental caries. This is data from 2009. 37% of our children in Head Start have decay, where the national average is 5%. As a pediatrician, we start referring our babies as young as 1 year of age for routine dental care, but it is difficult for all our kids to get access, easy access, to good and consistent dental care. Currently, all children in Brockton are supposed to be taking fluoride supplements, starting at 6 months of age to 16 years of age. So every child in Brockton is supposed to be taking fluoride every single day for about 16 years of their life. This requires that, because it's a prescription, they have to see their healthcare provider on a regular basis, make sure that all the parents and caregivers are giving their child fluoride every single day. Fluoride costs about $5 per child per month, which is more expensive than maintaining water fluoridation, which averages, as Maria said, about $1 per resident per year, and even less in a large community such as Brockton. Also, compliance is an issue. Most people don't give their child the fluoride for the full 16 years, so they're not getting the full benefits of systemic fluoride. From my experience working here, it's constant work trying to make sure that our patients get their prescriptions on a regular basis, fill it, and give it every single day. It's certainly hard for teens and young people to take medicine every day, so there's often lapses on people taking their fluoride. So many of our families don't get, most of our children do not get the optimal exposure to fluoride. So water fluoridation makes sense. Besides supplementing all the children in Brockton, the higher cost and need for parents to be compliant, besides supplementing, the care that we have to give our children is high. They, multiple dental visits, multiple doctor's visits, 4 dental caries. This, in fact, impacts our family, their work, their child's school. We also have a large number of children who actually have to undergo general anesthesia for dental caries. So just in the past year, we had at least 100 children at the health center who we screened as pediatricians for general anesthesia just to fix their teeth. They were that bad. And that's not counting all the children that get crowns, extractions, in the dentist chair. Still amazes me to see the number of children with crowns in their baby teeth, as many as young as 3 or 4 years of age. And I've worked in private practice, and I also worked in New York City previously, never seen so many cases of dental caries as I've seen here. It's not just beneficial for the children, but water fluoridation saves money for all residents. For every dollar spent on fluoridation, it results in about $38 of savings in dental bills and fillings per resident. Fillings need to be replaced, so if children have fillings young, those need to be replaced about every 12 years, so this is a lifetime problem that affects everybody. The community has been working hard to address the problem of dental disease in this community. We are all trained in our pediatric department at the health center to apply fluoride varnish, which helps prevent decay in teeth that have already erupted, and we are very aggressive about getting our children to dental care. The dentists in the community are varnishing teeth, putting on sealants, which is helpful. People in WIC, Head Start and a lot of the Brockton public schools provide dental care, but these are, once the teeth are erupted, and this is all topical rather than working on the systemic problem. These help, but without an effective systemic method of getting fluoride to our children for the prevention of caries and dental care, our community is not enjoying a benefit that it could have. We have, in the city of Brockton, from what I've seen, we've come together on public health issues such as asthma and lead exposure. This is really time for our residents to work on implementing community water fluorination so all our residents can benefit.
Thank you. Councilor Rodriguez, you still have the floor.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I have a couple questions at the end, so I'm actually going to open it up and let my colleagues ask the
Thank
questions
you.
That they need to ask.
Councilor Barnes.
Yes, I don't really know if this question would be maybe for Mr. Rowley. And I know he's not one of the invited guests, but it has to do with
our...
I think
there's no objection, but he may... Why don't you ask your question, and we'll see if he can answer it for you.
Okay. I kind of just wanted to ask. So with the process of including the fluoride into our water, are our systems up to, I guess, par to be able to handle it? Or would there be some kind of extreme changes in what we have now and based on kind of the condition of our infrastructure?
Yeah, we would have to, because we have three entryways with water comes in here from Silver Lake, and then we have the Brockton Reservoir and the D-cell. Mm-hmm. So we would have to have that engineered and designed on how we were going to set this up for our fluoride.
Okay. Now, does that, because if I remember correctly, and this was a while ago, they were talking about, when they kind of first came up talking about this all over the country, there were some places that... they put too much fluoride in the water and it ended up being harmful to some of the people. So I didn't know how does that work, I guess? And would, you know, okay.
Bill, you want to step forward?
Thank you, Mr. Rowley.
Good evening, councilors. The recommended level of fluoride in the water is 7 parts per million. Maximum is 4 parts per million. That's when you can have a problem, and it's a 4 or over, 4 parts per million. I believe the DEP requires that if fluoride in any city in the state of Massachusetts goes over 2 parts per million, that they have to be notified. And again, Brockton right now is 3 parts per million natural fluoridation.
Okay.
So what we have to do is to bring up the optimum level to 7 parts per million.
Okay. How did we get the natural parts?
It's natural because it's spring fed. It's through the earth, through the rocks. That's why some states have to reduce the fluoride in their water supply because it's a natural process and theirs is higher than the recommended 7 parts per million.
Okay, and how long would it take, I guess, to get it up to par, or get it up to the 7 parts per million in your estimation, if everything was all set and all of the engineering research was done and we had the funding, how long would it take to get us up to that level?
Well, as soon as you start putting the fluoride compound into the water system, it's going to start. And when all your water is mixed, it's a continuous flow, as you know, because we're using 10 million gallons a day, roughly.
Okay, so now we do periodic testing for different kinds of pollutants and all those kinds of things in our water supply. Would that increase the amount of testing that we would have to do in that same vein? Would that put strain or pressure on the water department to have to be able to do that?
I would say initially you'd want to check it more often than you do other chemicals.
It's like chlorine in a pool, right?
Yes. Well, as you have a chemical report that's about... that many pages. This is the Brockton water supply. 2013, we have one for 2014, and you're talking all of these here. This is just one report. But you can test the fluoride in the water anytime you want, and it's not that difficult.
Right, no, I would assume so, but I'm just saying, would we be required to, if we were to take the step to fluorinate our water, whatever, was it fluorinate? Okay, fluorate, excuse me, our water, I would just assume that we would need to be, or it would be prudent of us to do a little bit more testing just to make sure that we don't have an exorbitant number of fluoride per parts to end up like some of these places where it happens naturally. Who knows? The land could change, all of these things that you said, the elements could just naturally change, and that could increase our parts per million and cause us to have problems. So I would just assume that we would need to test it more, and that was my question. So if we had to test it more, would that put a strain on the water department or on your department going forward?
The money doesn't come out of my department. It comes out of the DPW.
Okay.
Would it put a strain on testing? No, I don't believe so. And it's not that difficult. You're testing one compound, or one ion, actually, the fluoride ion.
Okay. And also, thank you, Mr. Tadegla. So, just a question, would it change the taste of the water now that we get?
No, there's no effect. The taste, color, smell, there is no change.
Okay, so how did those communities that found out that they had an overage of fluoride, how did they know if it's kind of like carbon monoxide, like you can't taste it, smell it? How would they know? How do we know if we were...
You test it. And you have a system, and this is what we have to look at, your engineer has to look at. Each source of water, which would be Silver Lake, the Avon Reservoir, and Aquaria, would have the test, the controls for the induction of the fluoride compound into the water. I'm assuming there would be an alarm or something like that if in fact there was a true malfunction.
Oh.
Okay, this is a whole system. It's the same as, you just don't throw chlorine in there. You have to have a system that interjects it into the water.
Right.
And the fluoride would be the same.
Okay. All right.
It's an acid that is put into the water, fluorosalicylic acid.
Okay. I think that's it for now. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Azak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. Tataglia.
Good evening, Councilor.
I have a few questions for you for the Board of Health and then maybe for the doctor. Why did the city of Brockton, do you know why we never signed on beforehand to have it put in our water system?
It was voted on by the Board of Health back in 1972, and it went before the council. There were a lot of pros and cons on it at that time. Plus, the money was the issue. You're looking at between, let's say, $45,000 to $65,000 per year for the chemicals and the maintenance of the equipment. What the Massachusetts Department of Public Health is doing for us, which was not included back in 1972, is to put the entire systems in place for us at each of the three locations. And until that's done, the city of Brockton is not going to spend any money on it.
Okay, very good. Thank you. So I just a couple of questions for the doctor, Dr. Dole. Good evening, doctor.
Good evening.
So as a parent, from when my children were infants, I've had this, when I take them to the pediatrician, they would ask us if our water was, they'd ask us where we lived and if our water was fluorinated. And of course, I knew that Brockton wasn't, so I would give supplements, whether it was the water in the jugs for babies or the vitamins or the liquid vitamins, which were mixed with fluoride. Now, after the doctor actually stopped prescribing them, I believe once the children, my kids were around seven or so, because there was a big controversy, as my colleague mentioned, health-wise, with fluoride and increase in fluoride. A lot of people linked it with cancer and other issues. Mm-hmm. So that was a concern to me as a parent, as, you know, giving too much fluoride to an infant. So that's something that would be a concern. The other concern right now, to me, is this fluoride's mostly going to affect, good for infants. I mean, as adults, do we get the same benefits as adults as children do, or is it mostly geared to increase the health of young children, infants and children?
It does, it's not as strong of an impact on adult teeth, but it does slow down decay in communities with water fluoridation to have less tooth loss in adults. And, you know, especially in a poorer community, there is a high level of tooth loss. So it can stop progression of tooth decay and root loss in adults.
Okay. And as far as the controversy between cancer and an excess of...
Yeah. The American Dental Association has done a lot of studies. I mean, water fluoridation was introduced in 1950, so there's been extensive studies. So there were things about cancer, hip fractures, bone health, and none of that has proven to be a problem. With the issue with fluoridation, water fluoridation, you know, the level is 0.7. The level that we worry about is 4 parts per million, so we're not even close to that. And also the number one reason for fluorosis, which is the high exposure to high levels of fluoride, is swallowing toothpaste. And the studies for the American Dental Association look at everything that's reported by dental changes for fluorosis or exposure to excess fluoride. And it's basically cosmetic. The teeth look a little different. The white, it might look thicker and whiter, and the enamel looks different. The vast majority of cases have been either mild or very mild, and it's usually associated, it's not associated with systemic fluoride as much as the swallowed toothpaste, the topical. Because fluoride is excreted, so, you know, it's excreted through the kidney, and that's why we always recommend that children don't swallow their toothpaste and use the size of a pea, because that's the number one reason for high levels of fluoride, not the water.
Okay. Now, as far as it, if the water is treated with fluoride, the best way to drink it pure water from the faucet.
Mm-hmm.
Now, has it been there been a study of how many people actually drink the water direct? I know a lot of people drink the bottled water, or the not everybody's drinking faucet water, but that's how it would be consumed, is through faucet water.
Yes, there are, you know, certainly the number of people who are drinking bottled water has gone up much higher, so less people drink tap water. I don't have the exact statistics. So there was a study done, I think, in Brockton here. But a lot of everybody cooks with water.
So it's not, it doesn't evaporate when you cook, it does stay within the water?
It's in the water, so you're going to get exposures from other places. And you wouldn't use water, most people use bottled water for their babies anyhow, so the very young children under 6 months, you would use bottled water to make formula, unless they're breastfeeding, which we always promote. But over 6 months, we do want our children to have fluoride, so from 6 months on, we want them to have the fluoride.
Okay, very good. One last question.
Sure.
I know you mentioned a lot of tooth decay and crowns. Are we with this, I'm going to call it a campaign or a program, are you also pushing oral hygiene? Because I think that water alone, isn't going to save our teeth.
We have to teach
oral hygiene.
It's definitely multifaceted, and this is one part in water fluoridation. You know, can reduce the risk of dental caries by 20% to 40%. Certainly, you know, tooth care, aggressive visits to the dentist. We used to wait till the child was 3. Now we want them as soon as their teeth are out. As early as 1 year old, to start going to the dentist for hygiene. I talk to my parents every single time I see them about brushing their teeth, avoiding chewy foods, drinking water, limiting juice. So there's a campaign everywhere. Our parents who see WIC hear the same thing. They see the dentist there. They get fluoride varnishes. We're still doing the topical treatment, so this is definitely a campaign, and this is one major part of it.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Dolan, I just had a quick question for you. Good evening. How are you?
Good, thank you.
Well, first of all, thank you for being here. I also want to give my thanks to Councilor Rodriguez. This is long overdue, and I'm a father of three kids, you know, 9, 6, and 4, and it's a pain to get the refills and go to CVS every month, and then
right.
You forget some nights to give it and stuff. So to me, I think it makes sense. I guess my question would be, relative to daily consumption of water, if it's in the water, is there a maximum consumption that a child, is there a potential overdose of fluoride? I guess that's one way to say it. If someone's very active, say they play soccer or basketball, and they're just gunning down water,
mm-hmm.
can a child or a youth have too much fluoride per day?
No, you can't overdose on fluoride. So it may peak briefly, but as I said, it's excreted through the kidney. So
yep.
Any extra, just like anything, like if we had too much salt or anything, our body takes care of it. So you can't overdose on fluoride.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, if you swallow a tube of toothpaste, maybe, but it will cause
you don't
some
know my
problems
kids.
With the changes. Yes. Nice of a pee and spit it out. But drinking water will not overdose.
Okay. Thank you. And I just had one question for Mrs. Mendez. Thank you again. I guess my question is relative to the DPH, you're pretty confident DPH will pay the initial cost. Is there any analysis done relative to future costs? Are there any type of federal, state, or private grants that you're aware of that a municipality like Brockton could seek for future costs down the line?
Oh, absolutely. And the first step is really the startup cost. So we're confident with DPH, and we actually missed an opportunity some time ago there was an RFP put out for Brockton to apply, and you know, some miscommunication happened, and we weren't able to actually lock down that payment. So if we had this conversation before June, we would have had money that we needed to spend that would have been awarded to Brockton. But because we missed that deadline, now they're still saying to us, listen, we will still fluoridate Brockton. We just don't have that with us right now. But as far as future costs, I'm sure that we have great relationship with them. And this is something that DPH is highly supportive of. So they are willing to work with communities that are seeking to have their water fluoridated to not let cost be an issue, not to move it forward.
Okay, great. And then just my last question is relative to the estimate financial impacts, like on Brockton, was your figures, and again, they were guesstimates, they're not hard numbers, but were those figures based upon multiple water sources that Brockton has?
So I'm not so sure. We've been working very closely with Taunton to be able to, they recently got, Taunton recently became fluoridated, so we've been working with them to best understand their cost, what do they have to pay for, their systems, what it all looked like. So I'm not sure if we took the multiple sites into consideration. However, again, I'm confident, and DPH has said whatever that startup cost number is, they will cover that entirely.
Okay. And I think, in my humble opinion, I mean, it makes sense.
Absolutely.
For long-term health of Brocktonians, it makes sense. It's short money. So thank you again
Absolutely.
For all you're doing. Thank you, Councillor.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councillor Lally.
Hi, I just had one question. I'm not sure who it's for, really, but I had a couple of concerned residents reach out to me, and I just want to, you know, clarify. There's no negative impact to with the fluoride, right? Nothing can.
Councilor, with all these studies that have been done in this country. There are no negative impacts. As far as you had mentioned, one of the councilors had mentioned, Councilor Sullivan, the only way you could have a problem with fluoride is if a small child, baby, a small 1 or 2 year old person, baby, actually swallowed the entire contents of a tube of toothpaste. Then you would have to get them to a doctor immediately. because the toothpaste has approximately 1,150 parts per million, which is quite high. However, it's not swallowed, so that's why it does not count toward the fluoride content that we're talking about now. I mean, everything that we have in the water and in toothpaste, etc., they all add to the fluoride. This is all taken into consideration when the CDC recommended 7 parts per million. And just one other thing. I know Ms. Mendez mentioned that we would like to have the approval of the council. I don't know how this is done as far as the dollars are concerned. Where does this money come from? The only thing I can tell you right now is that the Board of Health has voted to require the city of Brockton to fluoridate the water supply. This is not a wish of the Board of Health. It's a requirement of the Board of Health. And now it's up to the council and or the council and the mayor to answer that requirement. We have to publish that in the paper for 90 days because any resident of the city can get a petition up to have it put on the ballot to stop the fluoridation of the water supply. However, they have to get 10% of the registered voters. That is kind of highly unlikely in that time period.
Just a point of parliamentary information, I was going to point this out to Ms. Mendez. Any vote tonight is not binding. This is strictly a resolve. My guess is, and we'd have to talk to, is that the Board of Health would have to apply for a grant, and we would have to accept the grant, and that would basically be probably our only step in the process, is that the grant can't be accepted. Only the City Council can accept the grant, so my guess is that the Board of Health would have to apply for the grant, and then it would have to come to us for approval of accepting the grant to expend the monies.
Now, when you say a grant from whom? The council?
From
the city?
From you're telling me that the Department of Health...
Oh, that's a different... You're talking two different things here. You're talking the installation of all of the equipment at three locations. That would come before you if the Board of Health submitted the RFP from the state and was approved for it. Then yes, we would come before you for the council to accept the money and to allow us to spend the money.
Correct. And any money other than that had to be spent would have to be an appropriation from the mayor's office to
us to approve.
So that would be the process. But tonight, this is strictly resolved, which gives what's basically called the sense of the council. So it would not be approval tonight, even with a positive vote to move forward, but it would tell you basically what the council's feelings are on.
And just one other fact, Councillor. In the United States, 75% of the people on community water systems receive fluoridated water. Massachusetts is at 70.4%, and it's ranked number 32 out of 50 states.
Thank you.
District of Columbia and Kentucky are almost 100%, New Jersey 14.6, and we're at 70.4.
Thank you. Councilor Lally, are you still?
No, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other before? Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I want to thank my colleagues that actually voiced their positive support and had some questions on this matter. As I said, as a longtime resident in this city, we've talked about this issue for the longest time, but yet somehow we haven't really done anything about it. We have a great opportunity to get the state to come down and help us with this process. I know that this is not an order, but merely a resolve, but it's a resolve that actually goes to show that this council is in support of the work that's being done in the community. And I think based on the fact that the Board of Health has supported this at 100%, I urge my colleagues on this body as well to do the same thing so that we can kind of move forward and figure out the way to, there's a process that needs to go into play. I'm sure the Board of Health will take the lead on this, and whatever we can do from this committee, we'll go along and do that as well. But, you know, I honestly want to just leave this here. I know that a lot of times people say, you know, there's a lot of people drinking bottled water and going to the doctors when they're supposed to and doing the right thing. But we live in a very poor community, and there's a lot of people in this community that aren't doing that. I'm one of the ones that actually, I drink tap water. I don't drink it out of the tap, but it goes through a filtration system, through a refrigerator, but I drink it. And Brockton has great water. And we need to encourage people to do more drinking of our own water instead of spending money to buy bottled water that we have no idea what it's coming from. But at the same time, I believe that we as a government, we have a moral duty and obligation to provide the taxpayers and the residents of the city with whatever means we can to provide them with a better health. I mean, we talk about some health issues on a regular basis. We talk about the opioid issues and some of the issues that we face in the community. We have an obligation as a body, as a government body, to do what we can to support initiatives that are community-based so we can move forward in providing our community with the best possible instruments so they can have a better life. And with that, I would like to make a motion to move this recommendation favorably to the full City Council.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. And
on the motion, Mr. Chairman, if you don't mind. Excuse me.
Vance?
When I stepped out earlier, I didn't hear the beginning of this. Did you mention, Maria, that we missed the first RFP session? When's the next one anticipated to come that we might be eligible for the startup funding?
Okay. So it will not come down through an RFP process. The money will just be awarded to Brockton.
Okay, so we can apply any time.
Yes, so once we, Brockton says, and the process is set up to say, you know, next step is to get fluoridated and it's approved and moved forward, then the funds will be provided to the city of Brockton.
And this will go after the engineering review and all of those things for our systems and everything?
Yes, we will have to work with an engineer to understand the current system, what we need to do to be able to have it prepared and ready for the fluoride to be added at all three sites.
Okay, and again, just to be clear, I know you said that the public health, they said that they're willing to fund any amount of money to get this done, understanding the need that we have in this in the community, but have they put a cap on anything?
Nope, whatever that startup cost is for Brockton, that amount will be covered fully.
Okay, just want to be clear and everybody hears. Okay,
yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you,
colleagues.
Okay, motion made and seconded to recommend to the full City Council. Not many people here will remember, but Councilor Moncevich will be very happy, Paul, wouldn't he? All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably to the full City Council.
Thank you.
Madam Clerk, item number two, believe it or not.
Order. Authority for the mayor to lease certain land to the Brockton 21st Century Corporation for economic development purposes, including but not limited to construction of a baseball stadium, conference center facility, upon such terms of conditions as the mayor shall determine to be in the best interest of the city. As authorized by order of the City Council dated November 13, 2001, be and is hereby rescinded, accepting the existing lease agreement between the City and the Brockton 21st Century Corp, shall remain effective for any remaining term. Invited, Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter.
Mayor, if you could step forward, please. We finally made it to item number two.
But I guess it is I'm the only one invited on this one. I'll come on up here.
Councilor Farwell.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Mayor. Thank you for being here.
Good evening, Councilor.
I'd like to start off by saying that none of the issues we're wrestling with now about Campanelli Stadium and the Shaw Center are attached in any way to your administration, and they post-date my administration. I think we've reached a point where there are a lot of issues that have to be resolved. We want the best possible outcome for the taxpayers. So this order in no way, and I want to say this to you publicly and personally, is any suggestion that you couldn't handle the issue, that in any way you wouldn't act in the best interest of the taxpayers. Purely and simply, in a most transparent way, I just want to bring the council back into this process so that we work as a team with you, the councilors, department heads to the extent that they're needed, and we take a look at all of the different issues that have developed and may develop over how best to proceed with protecting the interests of the taxpayers with respect to the Shaw Center and Campanelli Stadium. This was the vehicle that I chose to do it. For whatever reason, the council back in 2001 chose to step aside and empower the mayor to make all of the critical decisions about economic development, the stadium, the conference center, the construction of it. I will not impugn anyone's motives back then and say that they didn't operate in anything but good faith, but unfortunately I think revenue projections and some other things just did not come to fruition, and consequently we now find ourselves with a facility that needs about $900,000 worth of repairs and some governance issues. So, and I'm not about to put you on the spot tonight. I just would like you to know, here is the intent. We'd like to work with you. I'd like to have my fellow councilors involved. Any options that you might want to come up with over the next few weeks, particularly as they relate to the FY17 budget process, I think would be very helpful. But this isn't an evening where I hope my fellow councilors wouldn't pin you down with any particular commitments or any particular course of action. But it's an ongoing issue that I think needs the best possible resolution. And with that, I again thank you for being here.
Well, I appreciate your comments, Councillor, and I accept this in the spirit of cooperation. So there's no offense taken by me, and you know, we inherited the lease and the situation in the ballpark, and I think we all want it to look forward in what would be most advantageous to the residents and the taxpayers. So in terms of this specific language, there is an existing lease that goes till 2021, so I don't believe this would directly impact that. I think, as you stated, would be looking towards the future, that the council would be involved in the future.
That's correct. I would say to you, though, and I would ask this of you, I would not be in favor of changing the name of Campanelli Stadium. I obviously read in the newspaper the suggestion that the naming rights might be sold. Whether there was a formal written agreement or not, I would hope that the corporation, particularly if you so feel inclined to urge them to do so, would not engage in any process to change the name. Frankly, I think when a family or a gentleman gives that kind of money towards a city project and then a decision is made to put his name on that stadium, it really would be a slap in the face to take the name down and name it something else. So that would be one request that I would have of you tonight, which may or may not dovetail into this order if it's adopted at the next city council meeting. But those are the types of things I just would like to make sure we're all involved in.
So, Councillor, I did not make the suggestion regarding a possible name change. I believe that it was a discussion at a board meeting. I don't think it ever advanced beyond a discussion at a board meeting stage, but my sentiments would be more in line with yours. Campanelli family made a very generous donation of $2 million at the time, and I think that the spirit of putting the name on the stadium was to recognize that very generous donation. So I agree that we need to work together in terms of thinking about what the best model going forward would be for the future use of that facility and how we pay for it and how we maintain it. I don't really see the name being part of that discussion at this point.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councillor. Any other councillors? Entertain a motion.
Move favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded for a favorable recommendation. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably.
Mr. Chairman.
Councillor.
I'd like to move that we take item 16 out of order.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to take item 16 out of order. All those in favor? Opposed? Madam Clerk, please read item number 16.
Resolved that the Commissioner of the City's Department of Public Works and the Executive Director of the Old Colony Planning Council, or his designee, be invited to appear before a committee of the City Council to discuss options and recommendations to be forwarded in a report to the Massachusetts Department of Transportation for improvements designed to enhance the safety of the public and the orderly flow of vehicle in this area of the city. Invited, Larry Rowley, DPW Commissioner, Pat Soramello, Executive Director.
Councilor Farwell.
Good evening. Good evening, Mr. Chermella and Mr. Rowley. Mr. Chermella, I didn't want you to perhaps nod off as we go through the entire agenda here, and I appreciate you coming by, and I appreciate the work of your agency. At a recent Ward 5 meeting, which Councilor Beauregard held, you made a statement that I thought was very interesting, and that is that if the DPW commissioner of the city were to forward some recommendations down to Mass Highway in either Middleborough or Taunton or Lakeville, wherever it is, that they might take a look at that intersection. And in particular, I remember Senator Brady's aide mentioning that as you travel eastbound on Pleasant Street and you approach the intersection of Reynolds Memorial Highway, it's quite challenging to make a left-hand turn. And basically what I'm looking for is some recommendations through Mr. Rowley or through your agency as to how we might do something to enhance that intersection. I know a lot of work was done. I know a prior report has been issued, but I do travel through that intersection quite commonly, and it is challenging. I'm not quite sure it was engineered quite the way that we might have liked, but it's there now. A lot of money has been spent. So with that, I'd like to hear your feedback as to what we might do to take a look at the flow of traffic and make some improvements.
Okay. Just to bring everybody up to date a little bit, there was actually this project was completed in 2011. It was opened in August of 2011. There was the summer of 2012, we got some, actually the police and the fire department had some complaints in regards to a lot of accidents happening at that particular location. And at that time, I think towards the end of that year, we working with the commission, we were able to meet with the MassDOT District 5 office to go over and see what could be done to help improve some of the complaints that they had there. And if I recall, that study was completed, I think, January of 2013, which came out with some recommendation. And some of those recommendations were basically that some of the traffic controllers' heads didn't line up particularly right with the direction you were going. Modify existing single phases so to implement the protected left turns on some of the intersections, which it was done actually on the westbound West Street traffic going onto Pleasant Street that was designated as a left turn phase for that particular left turn, because before it was you had four lanes of traffic heading south, two were for the eastbound on Pleasant Street and two were going straight across on West Street. And what was happening, there was a lot of conflicting movements with the left turns going onto Pleasant Street, northbound left turns onto Pleasant. That particular piece of the recommendation was completed. There was to install loop detection for eastbound exclusive left turn, which I think is the one you were talking about. For whatever reason, that particular one wasn't done because it would have changed the whole engineering opportunities for the, you know, you'd have to just redo the whole setup of the traffic signal itself. There is sufficient room over there in the, actually it's striped yellow lines, which a lot of people now are using that as a left turn anyway. They're going over the yellow stripes and using it to make a left turn. But it's not only making a left turn, it's a 120-degree left turn, so it's kind of really awkward. I think when the that particular project was designed, it took in consideration the Christie Way coming onto the mall entrance, so that a lot of the traffic would use that particular road for that instead of making a left turn. I think that was part of the thinking behind the design. I did mention at the meeting there, That if there's anything we can do to help the city try to resolve some of those particular issues, we could entertain some sort of a meeting with MassDOT to go over some of these things. But as far as I know, as of this time, they're all done with those improvements. That particular intersection was funded through the ARRA funds, which was a stimulus program back in 2008. And like I said, as far as I know, most of the work has been completed from MassDOT, but we're always open to try to set up some sort of meeting between the city and the OCPC and the MassDOT District 5 to try to see if there's anything else we could do to try to improve that intersection. As you mentioned, that left turn, I don't know what it would cost to do that, but it's something that we could talk about with the district.
Sir, do you know if it's possible, given the signalization that's there now, to have a delayed green light for traffic coming westerly on Pleasant Street? In other words, give the people traveling easterly on Pleasant Street a green light so that they can either go straight, they could go right onto West Street, or they could take a left onto Reynolds Highway, and then perhaps 15 or 20 seconds later, have the signal turn green for the traffic traveling westerly in Pleasant Street. I mean, I think that might alleviate some of the difficulties.
I think there is opportunities to do that. Again, I don't know how it would be funded and how much it would cost, because you may have to take in consideration adding an additional head on the thing there to make the left turn move. I don't know if that would impact the design that's there now, but it's something that could be looked at. Again, that would require maybe some funding from the city to bring in a consultant.
Yeah, I mean, I would not suggest that. I know the budget is so tight, and it's certainly not up to a councilor or even the council to supervise the DPW commissioner. That's clearly within the prerogative of the chief executive. I guess what I'll do is I'll network with you and see if perhaps I can talk to District 5, and if any of the other councilors have any issues, they can certainly bring them up tonight or let me know, and perhaps if we send some information down to District 5, they'll come up and take a look at it and see if there's something that can be done to alleviate some of the frustration that people encounter.
And we get those complaints every day too. And it is, it's a real tough location. It's a very complex intersection. Just to give you an idea, you know, I was looking at some numbers just before I came here. You know, from Reynolds, coming south on Reynolds, you're talking about 35,000 trips a day on the average day. Pleasant Street heading west, right before the intersection, you're talking about 22,000 trips a day. Going east on Pleasant Street, it's about 10,000 trips a day, and coming across from West Street, going towards the mall, you're talking about 21,000. If you add all these up, you're talking about 88,000 trips a day. So if you take and divide that by 24 hours, it's almost 3,700 trips a day that are going through that intersection. It's a very complex intersection. As if you recall, before it used to be two intersections there.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's a lot of cars. And plus you got the peak hours, which could double what, you know, what's going through there during the peak hours, because it's not a straight, you know, 88 divided by 24. You know, you get the peak hours where you're getting a lot more traffic. So it's a very complex intersection, and we're moving a lot of cars. It's probably one of the most busiest intersections in our region. Could be in the state, too. I mean, it's a lot of trips.
Well, I appreciate your help, and especially coming tonight, and I will give your office a call. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Azak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome.
You changed.
That's my thoughts exactly.
I'm back again.
Good evening, Pat. Thank you for being here.
Sure.
And as we all know, this intersection is Ward 7 and part of Ward 1, so I've had a lot of calls on this intersection. It's one of the biggest concerns even before I was a city councilor. But I'm just, I also serve on the Traffic Commission, which recently, not too long ago, we had a developer that was looking at a piece of a property right there at the intersection, and they actually had a traffic study done, which they paid for. And we got it as at the Traffic Commission, but I'm wondering, did you see that traffic?
No, I haven't seen that yet.
You haven't, okay.
But that might open up an opportunity to do some of those improvements, maybe.
Well, there's been a lot of, they did a study, and the, actually, the lights have been reprogrammed numerous times, I believe, since the original, since the intersection was first there. They've reset it numerous times, and finally they're finding that there are less accidents, that it is improving, that it isn't as dangerous as it was when it was originally finished. So I would like to, I could get my copy to my fellow counselor, or if I'm, or get it to your office, but I know that they said that there was a study, they paid for a consultant to come in and do a traffic study, and they did find that it has gotten better in the past few years.
Actually, a couple...
Mr. Rowley's behind you nodding his head, so...
Yeah, actually, I think this summer they came out with, this past winter they came out with the top 200 accident location. And this particular location is number one on that top 200. But those particular years that they look at is 11, 12, and 13. Charlie, my assistant, and also the transportation program manager, was looking at some of the accidents that happened after 13. These improvements that were done later on, they were completed at the end of 2014. So some of the accidents in 2015, the accident numbers went down quite a bit compared to what it was in 2011, 12, and 13.
Yes, that's part of the information that was given to us. So I know Commissioner Rowley behind you is also serves on the Traffic Commission, and he had seen the same report, I believe, or he wouldn't know.
Yeah, I'd be happy to look at that.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
Thank Commissioner. Mr. Commissioner, do you want to add?
I reached out to the state today a little bit to see what was going on there. They did do some shields on the lights, less confusing with the light. It is a very confusing, and it's congested. It is a very, I shouldn't say, well, it is. It's an intersection that you really have to behave, you know, watch what you're doing. Mm-hmm. Because to take a left or to take a right, actually two lefts, east and westbound, it's hard going into the mall, or you're taking that left and you're heading south on West Street. It's like, oh boy, you got to hold on. Mm-hmm. But they did do some extra signage up there, and they, like I said, they retimed the signals. Maybe we can do it some other way, like you're asking, counselor. We can reach out to MassDOT. I did talk to them today, and they said, you know, whatever you want, we can discuss. So we will follow up. If that's with the green arrow, and I think that makes a lot of sense.
Thank you.
Do we actually, I don't know who can answer this question, but if we do our own studies, can it be done in-house, like within the departments, or does it have to be a special consultant that we have to bring in?
Yeah, no, we should bring in a special consultant to do a traffic study there, and they'll do the signalization. But Councilor, they already did that, so we can get that report.
Right, that's why I know they
And
was
I
their
also
expense,
did reach so. Out to the state, and they said since they've done their minor work that they've done, they haven't had any complaints on that intersection.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Cruz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a little history on this. I mean, we did about 3 or 4 years ago, we actually brought somebody and we came up with a list of recommendations. District 5 was terribly uncooperative at the time. And in fact, for almost 2 years, we couldn't get a phone call back or a letter back on the changes that were recommended by our engineer. They did, those changes they have made were by recommendations of what the city recommended. And it was when some management changed down at District 5. They were, the design was clearly designed just to get people off of the highway quickly. The design was not about what was best for the intersection of the city of Brockton, because as you say, that left-hand turn, and in our recommendations, there is a recommendation to have a left turn lane there. And again, it's just painted, The island is just paint, and most people do use it as a second lane. The state at the time told us they would not repaint it because it changes the engineering of the intersection. My only hope is that since they recently have ruled it the most dangerous intersection in the state, that they will start to look at it with us, because I can't imagine that they wouldn't, where it's now considered, again, it probably is based on those older years, because once we did make the timing changes and put the shields so that you, when you were in one of those four lanes coming off of Reynolds Highway, you couldn't even tell which light was yours if you don't come from Brockton and know the intersection. But I can tell you that we did make those recommendations. We did bring an engineer in 3 years ago, right after the intersection was opened, because it was clearly so dangerous, and we had terrible cooperation from the state on that. It has changed a little bit. I'm glad to hear them say to you, Larry, that they're willing to talk about anything, because it's not, there aren't that many changes after we made there to, I mean, you'll never make it without a major redesign truly safe. But it doesn't have to be as dangerous as it's been or as scary as it's been. If they would help us with the left turn lane there and a couple of other minor changes, and some of them they've already made. But it was a very frustrating time for a few years. Your predecessor will tell you we went to meetings where they told us they wouldn't even discuss it, would not even bring up the subject. Now, again, there's been a change in leadership at District 5 that I think has helped a little bit. But this isn't something that we've not tried to fix, and we have fixed it a little bit, but I'd love to get down and meet at District 5 with you, Councilor Fowle and Councilor Azak, I'm sure would join us, and see if they would even just do those other minor recommendations that are already in a report that we had done years ago.
Yeah, because I think some of it's just minor. It's just a matter of line painting in the lanes. As far as the loops, I don't think they'll. To put the loops in for the signals, you have to dig the street up to do that. So they're not going to want to do that. But as far as the minor line painting, they said they would listen. I don't know if they'll do.
Well,
but we could.
Let's try again then, because in fact, Councilor Stewart years ago said, "Why don't we just do it ourselves?" And we can't. It's a state intersection. We can't change the lights up there.
Correct.
But it needs. And again, it's better than it was, but it's still dangerous.
Okay. We'll reach out to them.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Councilor Barnes.
Yes, thank you. Both of you gentlemen, if I could. In some of the reports, I guess, Mr. Rowley, in the report that you received from the independent review, were any of the accidents or any of the reports or anything from public safety, for instance, you know, the fire trucks and the police coming in and out of there and going, you know, kind of facing the same kind of things that pedestrians face?
No, I think it was just the signalization and traffic counts.
Okay, but does that...
It didn't have anything to do with emergency vehicles.
Okay, are there any instances of emergency vehicles having some issues as pedestrian vehicles? Because, and I say this to kind of piggyback on what Councilor Cruz just said, I've also heard from the residents that the amount of accidents have gone down since the reconstruction and the subsequent reconfiguration that the first time when everybody said it was really bad. But the kind of accidents that are happening there now are more head on. So instead of kind of a T-bone or something like that or a clip, because you can't see and you can't really tell, they're head on going east and west and going north.
South.
Well, going... Wait, going west?
West and Reynolds.
To Reynolds, so. Right. So I just didn't know if public safety, if they had something also to contribute with that as well, with their emergency vehicles and with the timing of the lights and people being stuck in that big area as they're maybe coming through. I didn't know if that was an issue.
Well, I know with the fire department, they have some sort of remote control that it'll turn the lights whatever way they want to go.
Right, but I've been in the middle of it, and the thing,
green for them.
A truck has come, and I'm like in the middle seeing it, and especially if I'm coming from the mall going West Street, the way everybody kind of has to funnel into that one lane, it could bottleneck. And, you know, you hear a siren before you see it. Yeah. So, you know, we're all just kind of sitting there, and it's like, oh, there it is, and then you're having to maneuver. So I just didn't know if that were also an issue for...
We could reach out to them.
Okay. So I don't know if that will help in, you know, maybe, you know, getting some eyes on that better.
We can reach, yep.
Well, through the chair to my colleague, that the fire chief serve on the Traffic Commission, so, and they've done, they're right there. This intersection's come up numerous times since I've been on. I'm sure that it's come up beforehand. And I believe the accident, we've asked for like an accident report, the accident number has come down in the last few years.
They've come way down.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. In regards to the emergency vehicles, there is an opticon on the system itself, so the emergency vehicles do have an option to continue going in the direction that they're going, so they can control the lights as they're going through there.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All set, Counselor?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yep.
Counselors, any other questions, concerns regarding this matter?
Move favorable recommendation.
Second. Motion made and seconded. Send back to the full city council for favorable recommendation. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full city council for favorable recommendation.
Thank you, Counselor.
You're welcome, Counselor.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I'm not even sure if this has been done yet, but number 14, can we take it out of order and also postpone it to the next finance meeting, the last finance meeting in May, as Mr. Monahan is not here and neither of the parties?
Actually, we'll get to that later because I have a letter from Mr. Wall I wanted to read in. So.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
I withdraw.
Item number 3.
Welcome back. Order transfer of $455,753.33 from vacant and abandoned buildings registry account to demolition revolving account. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, James Casseri, Building Superintendent.
And excuse me, Mr. Chairman, one more. If we can just maybe take number 17 in conjunction with this. They are closely related, and to keep Mr. Casseri.
We'll take it after we do this on a motion. Councilor Monahan filed this. He called me earlier tonight. He was called into work for emergency, so he's not able to be here, but Mr. Casseri, if you want to bring people up to date on how this fund works.
The vacant abandoned fund is a fund that was set up years ago, and it was put in place to give us monies so we could maintain vacant and abandoned buildings. And since that time, the fund has been successful enough that there is a sufficient amount of money in there that we can now remove some dangerous structures that have been deemed dangerous by a board of survey, including the one that's already down on the corner of Frederick Douglass and Main Street. The reason we asked to move this money to the revolving demo account is because, if you recall, last year the council gave me only a $250,000 spending limit, and it has become necessary right now to need this amount to remove 5 houses plus the Kresge building, and that's where we're at.
Oh, yes.
Any questions, councilors? Councilor Farwell.
I just have a quick question. When we take down a building and we place a lien on the property,
yep,
obviously we're going to recoup the actual costs of the demolition. But are we allowed to add in some type of an administrative fee, because contracts have to be cut, they have to be signed, there's administrative work in the office that has to be done? It just would seem to me that if we only recoup the cost of the actual demolition, we've overlooked some of the administrative work that goes with that.
Right, and I think we can only bill. What we do is when we remove a building, we actually create a bill. We bill the owners or the responsible parties of that property. If that bill goes unpaid for 1 year, then it becomes a lien on a tax lien. Isn't that correct, Marty? And that's how that works. And we can only bill for expenditures we could actually show, but that's a point well taken that there are other expenses. I mean, I'd actually like to bring you up to speed on what it takes to remove one of these buildings. If you'll allow me a few minutes, I'll tell you what it took to get the Kresge building down. So on the 7th of March, the Public Property Department was out there at the site checking on the staging we had that made it possible for pedestrians to keep walking on the sidewalks, and they noticed that some of the facade was falling into the street. So they called me and Inspector Jim Plouffe went out there to inspect the building and observed that the parapet and other structural elements of the building were leaning towards the street. At that time, we called an engineer firm to come out and evaluate, and we did a border survey on the building. On April 9th, I received the report, and I read it, and I brought it to the mayor for him to read. He and I both agreed that we had no choice in the public safety but to close the streets until the hazard could be abated. We erected fencing and put signage in place to let people know before they got to that intersection that there was a situation there. At this point, the owner is notified by phone, by registered mail, and by a constable who actually delivered to him the order to make the building safe. And I'd like to thank the law department, as always, for their involvement in this. And there are so many departments that were involved in this that I have to thank tonight. So the owners were unresponsive other than to say the earliest they could get the funding is sometime in June, possibly. So at that point, we contacted DCAM to apply for an emergency waiver from procurement, which, because if we had to go through the normal procurement procedure, it would require RFP and it would take a long time, and the emergency waiver was granted. We then contacted three qualified demolition contractors to visit the site and submit proposals. At the same time we're waiting for the proposals, we contact all the utility companies, the gas, the electric, and the water department, and cut all the services to the building to prepare it for a demolition. The bid documents are returned and we accept the lowest bidder. Ramco Company was the lowest bidder at $191,000. Ramco then has to evaluate the building for hazardous material. They have to hire a licensed survey company to come in and find all the hazardous material, and once those materials are documented, they have to apply to the DEP for a right to remove those materials. Permission is given by the DEP for the abatement and removal of all hazardous materials, and that begins and takes place, and that takes about a week. After the materials are removed, the DEP inspects and gives us permission to proceed with the demolition. At that point, I contacted the DPW to remove the street lights that are in the way. I also contacted the fire department to remove the traffic lights. And I have to tell you that every department worked great together, the DPW, the fire department. And I'd like to give a special thanks to the police officers who for 3 days now have been out there, and I know they get paid well for when they're on overtime, but it has been doing nothing but raining and snowing, and those guys are out there. So, Chief, would you thank them for me personally? I would appreciate that. So once all these preliminary steps are accomplished, the demolition can proceed. The building is meticulously dismantled. All the materials are separated into three distinctive piles. There's an iron material, cementitious material, and all wood, and they all head to separate locations. The wood heads to some place that's a decomposition type. The iron heads to a place like Brock and Iron Steel, and the cementitious material will go to T.L. Edwards, where they'll make reprocessed stuff that we can build roads on. And so all this entire process is green, and it couldn't take place without the cooperation of all these departments, which kind of hits on the point you were making. You can see how much actually goes in here that we don't bill for.
Mr. Chairman,
that's what took place. So within less than a month, we removed, and I'll tell you, it was one stressful month for me, and I have to personally thank April and my inspectors, my public property department, and everybody who was involved. It went off with, as my father would say, without a hitch. It really went great. So with that, I'll take any other questions.
Mr. Chairman, with the indulgence of the council, I know he's not invited on this particular item, but may I ask Attorney Nasrallah a question? Good evening, Mr. Nasrallah. Is it possible to, through a civil action, recoup some of these ancillary costs that are associated with taking down a building? I mean, that was quite a litany of work that had to be done, and it just seems to me the base cost of the demolition shouldn't be sufficient, that we ought to be made whole in some other ways.
Well, we've discussed that. There will be a lien in place. We'll follow through with the lien. There is an expectation in this particular properties that development will come to fruition. Financing will come into place with the owners of the property, and we'll be able to recoup at that time. It's not a significant amount of money. We're out of pocket in relation to the amount of money that is in the framework to restore the property. But we have been in, we've had several discussions with the building department, are watching the development and status of the process, and we do intend on moving forward to collect those monies.
Well, just for my part, get whatever you can get, and it's much appreciated.
I've already been told that by the gentleman sitting behind me as well.
Thank you, sir.
All set. Councilor Azak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Nice to have you back.
Thank you.
Quick, I'm not sure this may be for you, Commissioner, or the mayor. Do we know the person who was in the process of purchasing it? Have you heard from them recently? I know before it went down that you contacted them, but do we know what their plans are? Or
well, as far actually,
councilors, what most of these questions are actually for the item number 17.
So I can keep. I'll ask it once we get there.
Why don't we move on the transfer, and then we'll get to item 17.
Thank you,
Councilor Barnes filed. Move are there any other questions on the transfer of the money? The monies.
I have one.
Councilor Barnes.
So with the cost that you estimated, it's probably around $200,000 for this one building, or more than that.
$191,000.
But does that also count the overtime for the police and maybe the transport of those three separate piles and all of those things?
Nope. We're picking up some of those costs.
Okay. Well, I'll just suggest that maybe.
And those can be leaned. Those
okay.
will be added to the bill.
Okay. So 200 and let's just say 250.
Yeah.
So with this amount, almost a half a million here, is that to go to other buildings, or is that for some other unforeseen cost for 121 Main?
No, we have five other buildings that are up for removal as well.
Okay, so this is just, I guess the impetus for this money is for this building, but it will be used to take down the other buildings that are on your list?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
And is the remainder of this money going to be enough, or will there be a request for more?
The money we're requesting is enough to do the work that I'm talking about.
Okay. And the other buildings, are they in as bad shape as this one? Or?
They're homes. They're in neighborhoods where a couple of them have a red X on them, which means that they're too dangerous for the fire department to even enter if they catch fire, and they've been a blight and have been determined by the Board of Survey. And when I say Board of Survey, what that means is by state law, we have to send out a Board of Survey. It consists of the fire chief, a city engineer, and a disinterested party who is an engineer firm that we use quite frequently. And when they go out to one of these buildings, they assess it, and they determine whether or not it can be rehabbed or if it's a teardown. And I have five that they're telling me have to come down in the interest of public safety. So the rest of that money will go to that. Mm. And it will help these neighborhoods out tremendously.
Okay, so now I sit on the Mayor's Housing Stabilization Committee that meets the first or second Thursday, you know, here at the GAR. So are you talking about those houses that have been identified? Are those the ones that are on this list? Okay, so the ones that Robert Jenkins mentioned.
Yeah.
And the attorney there.
The ones council on the meetings
that,
you know, they've got in a different.
Right, the list, right. Okay.
And that's where those properties have been forwarded to the building department.
Okay. And I know that some of those homes also that they are currently in court. The assistant city solicitor who came to the meeting, the last meeting, she did mention that several of them were being filed on to go through. So will this funding last you? Wait, what? I asked if they were the ones that were on the list.
Mr. Mayor, if you could come to the microphone just so the people at home can hear you.
Right. So we're dealing with a lot more than just five properties. As you know, Councilor, every month is all the agencies
right.
are at the table.
Right.
So I wasn't at the last meeting, but I believe that the attorney was referencing new receivership filings being filed in the housing court. You know, what we're trying to do with all those agencies at the table is bring about half a dozen properties each month forward to court to begin that receivership process.
Okay.
Because, as you know, it's a time-consuming process.
Right. That was my question.
But these five are five that have been on the list for a long time that all the agencies agree have to come down. And so our committee that we work on, after coming to that consensus, sent them to the building department, who sits with us there. Mm-hmm. And then the building department then, as Jim described, did the boards of survey on these various properties, and these are ones that the board of survey determined were dangerous. And I, you know, I agree with Mr. Kasseri, as you know, work in that committee, every single one of these are a blight
right.
on the neighborhood that they're in, and all of these neighborhoods will be far better off without these structures in the neighborhood.
Okay. I just wanted to get my mind clear and get orientated on what we talked about and kind of how that's working. So, okay, thank you with that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All set. Councilor Ianieri.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, just a comment. And to you, Commissioner, I do want to commend you and your staff and everybody else that was involved in taking down 121 Main Street. I think we did an outstanding job in doing that. And even as much as the street was blocked off for a couple of weeks, I think everybody adhered to the situation and remedied other sorts, ways of getting around the city. But congratulations to you people in pulling that off. I really do.
Thank you, Councilor.
The concern I just have is I hear we're talking about other properties to come down, and it sounds like it's more than five. It could be 10, could be whatever. I would just ask that every ward councilor sort of gets a list of and knows if there's something in their area that is coming down. I'd like to know that myself. So. And I think every other ward council would want to know it as well.
I can give you the five addresses right now.
Yes. Okay, if you're willing to relieve them, then that's fine.
We have 18 Park Street, 32 Tremont Street, 82 Hubbard Avenue, 580 North Montello, and 45 Howard Street.
Thank you, Commissioner.
And every vacant house that looks like it's in disrepair isn't a demo. I mean, it really has to meet the criteria for
right.
a demo.
Okay.
But if you have any problems in any of these vacant houses, and by the way, we have 562 of them, call the building department and we'll make them look as nice as we can.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Did I hear a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably. Full City Council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. And why don't you stay there, and Councilor, if you want to make your motion.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to take number 17 out of order.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to take number 17 out of order. All those in favor? Opposed? Madam Clerk, please read the order.
Resolved that the record owner of 121 Main Street, the Mayor, Superintendent of Buildings, City Solicitor, a representative of the 21st Century Corp, and Gary Leonard be invited to appear before a committee of this council to discuss the demolition of the building, the cost to the city, recouping the cost, and plans for the redevelopment of the property. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Philip C. Nazarella, Solicitor, Bruce Jackson, Brockton Main Street Improvement LLC, David Edelman, Brockton Main Street LLC, John Marion, Chairperson, Brockton 21st Century Corp. Michael Gallerani, Executive Director, Brockton 21st Century Corp. Gary Leonard, Main Street Manager, Brockton 21st Century Corp.
People, I did receive a phone call from Mr. Marion, who had a previous engagement tonight. Now, quite a bit of this, we've already gotten this information from Mr. Kasseri. Councilor Barnes, you file this?
Yes, thank you. I did, in conjunction with the Ward 2 Councilor, Councilor Monahan, who is not here, but he did send me with something to say about his position. So I filed this just kind of following what Councilor Sullivan did for the Ganley building to kind of find out what's going on in this building going the same route as that building. You know, promises of it being sold, releasing drafts of what the new thing is going to be, and you know, kind of having a public opinion and all of these things, and having it kind of go viral about the reconstruction of this area, and then all of a sudden it seemed now it's extremely unsafe and it has to come down. So my concern initially was just kind of, you know, who owned the building, and then finding out later that there may have been some funding issues with I guess this owner who
And I'd like to ask, Mr. Chair, did you get any word from these listed owners why they're not here, or if they weren't coming?
I did not.
No, you did not?
Did not.
Okay, all right. So I guess just trying to find out their whereabouts, if we know that at all. And I know my colleague asked about your communication with them since this demo proposal was done, but that question can come later. But I'm looking, too, at this survey and structural conditions assessment that you had performed, or that the city had performed by the Churchill Engineering, and I read it very carefully, and I actually called over there today, and I spoke with a Richard Churchill. And it made me slightly concerned, and granted, I don't know if this is all, you know, water under the bridge because the building is down now, but he informed me in no uncertain terms that he was not allowed to speak with me, and that he would have to either go through you or through Mr. Plouffe or through the city solicitor in order to speak with me about any kind of information released in this report. I tried to reassure him that we had access to this report, but like I said, in no uncertain terms, he would not communicate with me about the information in here. So, first of all, why is that?
Well, one point is it wouldn't be Mr. Plouffe. He was just calling out names. He's a gentleman. He runs a company that we have under contract. And in many instances, I end up with him and one of the attorneys from the law department in some litigation in court. So he has been told by me that no matter who calls him, that you are to tell that person that if they are requesting public information, that that request goes through the building department, and I would talk to the city solicitor, because quite frankly, Counselor, he doesn't know who you are. And we could be going to court on something. So we go to court all the time on these things. So he is not allowed to, over the phone, give information. That would be a public records request, and those were my instructions. So
okay.
He did exactly as I had instructed him to do.
Okay, and now that's fair. Hearing that explanation from you, and this was after we spoke earlier today. So, I guess I'll just ask you, you know, from some of the information that's in here. So in here, it does state that this is a follow-up to an original assessment that was done in June of 2003 by the Board of Surveyors. Where is that report available?
I don't have it with me, but what that report said, and if you recall, at that time, the tiles were falling off the building.
The first time.
Facade on that original report, which was 2013. And so we asked the owner at that time to make the building safe. He didn't have the funds to do it. And again, the mayor, again, made the right decision, as he did this time, along with myself, that we can't allow a dangerous situation like that to exist where there's people walking by the building all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So we had the tiles removed, and that is one of the liens, Counselor, that we have multiple liens on this building. But since that day, we were under the impression that at that time his project was going to move forward, and it hadn't. So in the 3 years since that original survey, the building has become in such much more disrepair that we had to take these further steps. But in 2013, we hadn't envisioned this. But another aspect to what you're asking, Counselor, is even the people who want to redevelop this site, mm-hmm. were going to demolish the building. So the fact that we demolished the building only progresses the project. The original plan, what we did is we left the foundation there. Right now, the foundation's still there.
Mm-hmm.
And the ground level slab is still there.
Mm-hmm.
Because the proposal is to put a new structure on the existing foundation. So even the project that was coming was going to remove the building. So this only furthers that project along if it ever does come.
Okay, so you said the owners in 2013. Is that the same owner, these people listed here for
yes.
the Brockton Main Street improvement? Bruce
yeah,
Jackson
yeah,
and David Edelman?
People. Yep.
Okay, so if they were having financial problems 2 years ago, 3 years ago,
I don't want to say financial problems, but they were in the process of getting their funding, and that's how these projects go, and they're still in the process of trying to fund their project. If you recall, I went through a similar thing with the Gardner building and with the last administration where that funding was delayed so long, we had to remove that building, which was even more stressful than this one. But sometimes the funding doesn't just come the way it's anticipated, but to me, that's always irrelevant. Once I hear that there's a possibility of injury or death, I just statutorily required to remove the structure. I have no choice.
Okay.
But I will assure you that, that was part of the plan. That building was going to be removed anyways. So that doesn't hurt the project.
Okay, so at that time, it says that that first evaluation suggested that the owner make the upgrades to it to make it sufficient.
Make it safe, as we say.
Right, or to make it safe, excuse me, to make it safe. So besides them having trouble with the funding, or is that the only reason why they didn't do that in these 3 years, and then all of a sudden this weekend it became a fever pitch and it became an acute problem?
It's pretty self-explanatory. I mean, we did what we had to do at that time, anticipating that a project was going to take place that never did, and now the building deteriorated to the state it was in just recently, which required a whole new border survey and a whole new approach, which was to remove the structure entirely.
I guess my question is, what took 3 years to get that done? Because if 3 years ago, and in this report, it says pretty much everything you just said earlier about the structural the unsafety of the building, and you know how it was, it should be torn down at least 3 years ago. And even some of my colleagues who have been familiar with that building years ago, that building's been in bad shape for 10 years, I'd argue. So I just don't understand what happened between 3 years ago when it was recommended that the owners make it safe.
But it wasn't to tear it down 3 years ago.
Right. So I'm just saying, what has happened in that time that all of a sudden Thursday, you know, the process started happening? But I mean, the street was closed off last month.
What happened is the roof collapsed into the building.
Okay.
During those 3 years.
Okay.
Ice and water that would have been not allowed to enter the building because of the facade that was removed enter the building, and
okay.
There's a process that's called frost wedging, and what that means is thaw and freeze. So every time the water thaws, it seeps a little deeper, and then it freezes that at night and expands and acts as a wedge. So it frost wedges, and it pushes the facade off the building, and in this case, it was pretty dangerous. It was getting real bad. So nature caused this to happen.
Okay.
At that
All
point.
Right. And are there any plans for, or anybody know any plans for what's going to be happening next? I know you said that the foundation is still there to do something with it and make it something, but do we have any plans? Are these old plans still valid, or are...
What my plans are is to have that, the mess cleaned up,
mm-hmm.
and these guys have been great, and they really, they did a fantastic job.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm anticipating the streets will be reopened on Wednesday. I don't make any promises on that, but that's...
Mm-hmm.
That's my hope. And what will remain is a slab that the entrances to the basement will be covered with metal plates that I'm going to ask the DPW to step up again, and they will. And that area will be fenced off, and it will remain a vacant lot with a concrete slab until such time as a developer comes in and or whatever takes place. That's really not my venue. That would be more a question to the city planner, I would say.
Okay.
As to what is going to take place in the future there.
Okay, I guess you just kind of ignited a little bit more fear now in me. So, I mean, if we've been waiting for this gentleman or these gentlemen or this LLC to kind of get themselves together to make the building safe, they couldn't do that. We had to take on that responsibility, and now we're going to have to wait for them to pay us or whatever. Going forward, now we fixed it, made it as safe as possible. Now it's an empty lot, and then now we got to wait for them to figure out if they're going to be able to do anything with the location. I mean, we're going to be saddled, you know, with another missing tooth, you know, right in the downtown as we're trying to get funding and trying to make our city more attractive to funding sources and investors. And we got this these people holding us up with whatever is happening. And I just don't want to continue to I guess, beat that LLC's dead horse and waiting for them to figure out what they're going to do and wait for their funding. And that just makes me really concerned.
I appreciate all that. However, all of that really has nothing to do with me.
I know. I'm just hoping that Mr. May can hear it in Phoenix and that he'll listen when he comes back.
I'm just statutorily required. I mean, it's actually, my job is very difficult, but in a way, it's simplistic sometimes. The book tells me if the Board of Survey says the building's got to go, then the mayor and I look at it, and we really had an easy decision, even though it seems complicated and hard. When the mayor and I saw that survey, we really, the mayor said, hey, Jimmy, let's close the streets and let's get rid of that building. And, and I appreciate that he was right on board.
Okay.
Made my job easier.
Okay. I do appreciate that, and I think I'm done for now, but I'll defer to my colleagues. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councillor Ian Eary.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner, I guess some of my questions and concerns have been answered also from my colleague at large. And I've been sitting here since 2004, and I think that's probably maybe the fourth investor that's wanted to do something at that corner. But as you pretty much alluded to, now we made it a little bit more easier for them because we've finally taken the building down, which I said should have come down 10 years ago anyways.
Right.
And every investor stood where you were and gave us the biggest song and dance, and the restaurant that was going to be unbelievable. Famous people are going to come, and now we're just now to the slab, which does concern me as well, and that's not your issue. But now that we've gotten to this level, my greatest concern is going to be, as well as how long, as you just said, well, we're going to wait and see what happens as we go into the future. But the future could be another 10 years, and I hope not. And I hope I hope that it's all going to be part of what we're trying to do here with the whole economic development plan and what we're trying to do with Main Street. I don't know how fast that's going to go either. I have my own opinion of some of that myself. But in any case, I just... Now I have that great concern of foundation being rested there. I see the mayor coming up to plate. I'd like to hear from you because I guess it leaves us all with a concern. I know you're trying to work on doing things downtown, but I think we need to allude to where we go from this point.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, first of all, I'm not sure that the vacant lot will look better than the monstrosity that was there previously because anyone that drives through the downtown makes negative comments about that thing that's been sitting on the corner. So I don't think taking it down was a great loss. There was no option in terms of safety. But in response to a couple of the concerns about how long do we wait, what happens to it in the future, and Mr. May is out of state at a conference. That's why he's not here this evening. He has been working with the owner of this property. It's not the same as the Ganley building because we don't own this property. It was changed hands privately a couple times. It was auctioned on a couple of occasions. Then the auctioneer bought it at an auction, and then he resold it to these investors 2.5 or so years ago. But as you say, they have been moving forward with plans to redevelop the site. And if that does come to fruition, it's a multi-million dollar investment right in the heart of the downtown. So we certainly want to continue to support that as long as it's feasible. However, we've certainly moved to protect the city's position on it, and I agree with you that you don't wait forever. So, Councilor Barnes, regarding your question as to what are they waiting for, what's taking place, what's been going on is, in order to make the project work, they have to secure a number of tax credits and special financing, very similar to the Trinity Project, very similar to the lofts. They've got to put together a number of tax credits and special financing to ever make the numbers work for the whole thing. So they are well into the process of the 40R process with the state. They did pay the fee to the state for the state review of the 40R application, and that has been being worked on. They're also seeking HDIP, H-D-I-P, state tax credits. That's a fairly new program that a couple of the developers are looking for, and that's state tax credits for market rate housing. So we certainly wanted to support a project that could potentially bring market rate housing to downtown. And that's being worked on. There's a little bit of a very technical issue that Rob May would have to explain that they're working on with the state, because there's also a mass housing financing available, and there's some small conflicts in the language between one program and another, so one program is going to have to grant some sort of a waiver to allow them to use both at the same time. So it's not that they've walked away or anything like that. They actually were just in front of the planning board last fall submitting their proposed plans for the building. In any event, we had this property when I came along already in the tax title process. We were already in land court pursuing a tax title foreclosure. About a year or so ago, because this developer appeared to be going forward and was working with the city on all these issues, we instructed our outside attorney to put a hold on the actual tax title foreclosure, because if we were to do that, it would have killed the project at that time. They would not be able to get financing on it at that time. In light of the recent events, when they indicated that they did not have the additional cash flow, extra cash money in hand of a couple hundred thousand to take the building down, and it was clear we had to, through Mr. Brophy, I did direct the outside counsel to proceed immediately with foreclosing the tax title to protect the city's interest in the property. So what that means is that will happen within, it's already been filed, so it will happen within a few days. When you do that, there's still a one-year period. There's what's called a one-year right of redemption on all tax title foreclosures. So the city doesn't actually take possession for 1 year. I thought, in light of the significant amount of money that we're now going to have leaned against that property, it made sense for the city to get that one-year meter running while we continue to try to work with this developer to see if they can get the project done. But I thought it was critical that now the meter's running. If these guys are not in a position to go forward in the next year, we'll be in a position to actually complete taking possession of the property. Does that mean we get all of our money back? No, not necessarily. We may get some or most of it back. We would then own the property. The property is worth more with the building gone than it was before. However, whether we would recover every single dime or not, really there's no way to tell right now. We would get some or most of the money, but it would present us with the opportunity to control the future of that property on a very key piece of the downtown revitalization. And if that scenario should take place, if the developer doesn't get his financing and his tax credits and everything together ready to go forward in the next year, in the interim, we will be taking possession in the fall of the Hotel Grayson property directly next door. That's already in the one-year right of redemption, which will come up in September. So at that point, we would actually control the Hotel Grayson parcel, the Kresge parcel with the old ugly building gone, ready to redevelop, and even on the other side of the Kresge, there's a parking lot between Marion's and the Kresge that's also a city parcel. So we would end up with three abutting parcels with the city owning, ripe for redevelopment, and may possibly present a bigger and better opportunity to another developer if this project doesn't go forward. So it's hard to tell you exactly what will happen. I don't know that we're in control yet at this point, but I do want to allay your concerns that we're not just going to be tied up forever and wonder what they're going to do. We have moved forward on the tax title foreclosure. The one-year meter will be running in the next few days. We are still actively working with the developer to try to help them with the 40R and the HDIP and other financing and tax credits that they need to acquire in the hopes that that project will go forward. When that project was in front of the planning board this past fall, it had quite a bit of support. It's three retail spaces, underground parking, housing up above. So, you know, over this past year, councilors, I mean, I think it made sense for us to try to work with someone that was a private investor that was seeking millions of dollars of financing to develop this spectacular project in the heart of the downtown. Unfortunately, as Mr. Casseri described, the condition of the building deteriorated substantially over the last couple of years. The roof was leaking, water's getting in the roof, taking some of that facade off the outside is now letting the water in to freeze and thaw, as he described. And as you look at that report that I saw, you know, when they use words like hazardous and unsafe, and looking at where that thing was sited right along a road and with the observations made by our own building inspectors, I don't think there was any option other than to take the building down in the interest of public safety. And as Mr. Casseri said, if these guys are able to get their tax credits and their financing in place, they were going to take the building down anyhow. So this does not impede the current owners of the property from going forward with their plans. Hopefully that sheds a little light on it for you.
It does, Mayor, and I appreciate that, because my greatest concern is that we have some type of control. And like you just said, we don't have total control, but right now we do have some control. I think that's what's most important to all of us, and even for what we're trying to do downtown.
And we certainly have the liens in place, so they can't do anything with it in terms of financing without paying off the liens. So if they do get the financing, we automatically get paid off. And we've started this one-year meter running on the one-year right of redemption. So they've got a year to see if they can get it done. If they don't get it done within the next year, it'll become our property.
Then it becomes our property. And I'm good with that. I just want to make sure that we do have control. To this point, we do. And I think that's what's most important. That's what was bothering me. So I'm not going to pick at it, because I think it's great that we're there. Just keep us in tune to it, because we want to know naturally. Okay, thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you, Councilor.
Councilor Razak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Actually, the mayor answered many of my questions. So thank you, Mayor. I just have a quick one. Was anything kept from the building, like in other buildings, for example, the Gardner building, there was a little sign. Was anything kept from the Kresge building?
There's a big pile of stuff out there if you want to go.
Which I heard is being shipped out of state.
Not that I know of, Council.
Okay,
there really wasn't very much in that building. It was pretty bad once the roof. But I will tell you that the Ganley building is in great shape. I mean, not the Ganley, the Grayson. The Grayson is really in
talk
great.
Talk about that another night. It's getting late enough. Anything else, Councilor?
Thank you.
Councilor Sullivan.
Casseri, you had mentioned, and thanks for all you're doing, and it was a collaborative approach, and it needed to be done. In terms of reselling the steel, the wood, and the concrete, does Brockton get paid on that, or is that
Ramco? Well, there's really very little value in any of it. All the stuff that goes to recycling is no one makes any money on it. The steel used to go for $500 a ton. Now it's up to about $1.50 a ton. But that's the contractors. That's part of.
So that's part of the contract. They get paid on whatever that is.
Yeah, but it's really not that much money there, Council.
Well, what do you think it is? What's Edwards make on that?
Edwards makes anybody who takes recyclable stuff, they dump it at Edwards for nothing. It doesn't matter who it is. I mean, they just dump it, they grind it up, the process of grinding it up and making it into recyclable stuff, and they sell it for like $5 a ton. It's really not lucrative.
So in terms of the 190 grand or whatever we paid, is that, and maybe Phil, you'd know that, is that standard practice where a municipality would forego that within a contract?
That's standard practice.
That's standard practice?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thank
we
you,
pay, we pay to get rid of the building. That's what we pay for.
Right, but they're getting 190 grand, and then they'll get whatever residual.
I don't even understand the logistics of how we would do it. We would go take the steel ourselves someplace and sell it. I mean, it would cost us money. Steel is cheap right now. There's really no value in it. It's going to cost them more money to take that stuff and load it on a truck and get it to Brock and I and Steel or wherever they're going to take it. Then they're going to make on it, paying prevailing wage for the gentlemen who will be doing that, and ladies. I mean, there's no money to be made in steel right now.
Well, it's got to be something, Jim, or they wouldn't do it. It's got
to
be something.
Yeah, but if you're paying a guy $70 an hour to load the excavator, and then you're paying the truck driver $70 an hour, and it takes them a day and a half to load it, I mean, it's really...
All right.
There's not much there.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Beauregard.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, you mentioned that you heard from John Marion that he could not make it this evening. What about the two other gentlemen from the 21st?
I did not hear anything from the other two gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'd entertain a motion.
Actually, because there have been several questions, I think that we can direct to the Brockton Main Street Improvement LLC. I would like to make a motion that we continue this to the last finance meeting in May and request their attendance.
We can certainly request. We can't
right,
insist.
Right, I understand.
Second.
Thank you.
Motion made and seconded to postpone until the next finance meeting?
The last in May.
Last in May. All those in favor? All those opposed? Postponed.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Kasseri.
Item number four. Let's read it fast. Let's get moving.
Order, transfer of $15,100 from animal control full-time salaries to animal control overtime, $10,000. Animal control department equipment, $5,100. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Thomas DeChillis, Animal Control Supervisor.
Good evening, Officer DeChillis.
Mr. Chairman.
Good evening, Councilors.
As an unabashed, unapologetic animal lover, I move favorable recommendation.
Second. Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thanks for your patience.
Thank you, Councilors. Have a good evening.
Item number five.
Order, transfer of $10,000 from Treasurer purchase of services, security, fire control, $3,000. Treasurer goods and supplies, registry of deeds, $7,002. Treasurer's personal services overtime, invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Martin Brophy, Treasurer Collector.
Good evening, Mr. Brophy.
Evening, Councilors.
Anyone want to make a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to full City Council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. You can stand right there, Mr. Brophy. Item number six.
Order that pursuant to Mass General Laws, Chapter 60, Section 15B, the Council accepts Mass General Laws, Chapter 60, Section 15B, and also that the City Council authorizes the Tax Title Collection Revolving Fund for fiscal year 2017 to be capped at $100,000 and the balance at the end of each fiscal year to be transferred to the General Fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Martin Brophy, Treasurer Collector.
Move favorable. This is a good
second.
Move.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full City Council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brophy. Item number seven.
Order, appropriation of $45,000 from Stabilization Fund to Information Technology Department, ITC Capital, to provide funding for expanding services to the City Hall phone system. The cost of this upgrade would include a customer service audio recording system, labor, and miscellaneous wiring. Note, CFO certification. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, William Santos, Acting Director, ITC.
Good evening, Mr. Condon.
Evening, Councilors. Union contracts that were funded earlier this fiscal year had as a provision this telephone recording system as part of the agreement, and the basic intent is that for certain functions the lines would be recorded to both provide information and protection of our workers in case there's an allegation of improper behavior, or to have a record in case the clerk himself acted improperly, and this would fund the acquisition of that system.
Councilor Barnes.
I just have a few questions. I think my question is to, actually I'll ask you, Mr. Condon, first. So the changing the system or having the system be a an audio recording system now, what's the cost for future upgrades or maybe downloading of any kind of technology to keep the system up or whatever?
Well, I don't think there'd be a significant amount there. This is $45,000, which should last for a while. I don't know whether there'd be a requirement in a few years to do any upgrading and maintenance. You probably ought to ask Bill Santos.
Okay, if I could. If there's any, I'm just asking if there's any new technology or programs with these kinds of things to upgrade them to be able to listen to voice prompts or know the keys and all that stuff.
No, there's a $600 maintenance fee per year for upgrades until the life of the item is, outdated.
Okay, so how far will this $45,000 go before we have to start to include the $600 in the budget?
It's every year. There is a maintenance fee of $600, a licensing fee which includes upgrades to the software company.
Point of information, I believe that would then be in his yearly budget that you'd be requesting.
It's right. A nice service.
Right, that's what I'm asking. So that'll start in this next budget?
Yes.
I see. So this is just to implement the system?
This is the purchase of the system and licensing.
And then the labor and installing.
Installation
Okay. And who's going to be recording it, and where is it going to be stored, and how can we retrieve it?
It's right here in City Hall, and it's a server-based system. It would be recorded with the phone system, and if necessary, would retrieve any calls. And it's based on names, extension, dates, whatever you can retrieve.
Okay, and then it'll say that this call is being recorded for quality assurance purposes, and like they say in the other places?
You have to announce that.
Okay. I know that City Solicitor Nesrella is not on here, but can I just ask him a question about liability with that?
You may. If there's no objections.
Thank you, Mr. Santos. So with that prompting, does that open us up for any kind of issues with lawsuits or people being particularly litigious on being recorded?
No, I don't foresee any. Normally, the recordings are, there's an introductory statement that you're being recorded, so I don't see anything.
Okay. All right.
As far as Privacy Act or anything of that nature.
Right.
No, I think it's more protective for both parties than it is opening up issues of liability.
Okay. And that will be on every line and every City Hall phone or every city phone?
No, I don't believe so, but they can...
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Nesrella.
There are about 50 lines in total. Not every City Hall line. It's just for designated lines for certain functions in the city which have a fair amount of contact with the outside public.
Okay. And those have been identified?
Yes.
Okay.
And negotiated with the unions, which ones are included or already negotiated.
Okay. Just as a point of information, can we get a copy of that? To see which offices will be recorded going forward? Is that something we can get?
I think we could have Mr. Santos do that for you.
Okay.
This was negotiated. There's one outstanding small union contract, but all of those other collective bargaining agreements that we've done with you over the past year, this item was collectively bargained with all of the unions. We're all on the same page. We have a clear understanding as to which lines the system will work on, which are essentially, to generalize it, Counselor, customer service lines.
Right.
Lines where we would anticipate residents, taxpayers calling in for constituent or customer services. So that's generally speaking the lines that have been identified. And we also negotiated with the unions as to under what circumstances would we go back and retrieve a call. So it's only under limited circumstances, and I would agree very strongly with Attorney Nesrella. One of the strengths, one of the good reasons to do this is to protect our liability. So if there is any type of allegation made against the city through a telephone call, we can go back and retrieve it to defend ourselves. So we believe this actually protects the city and its employees.
I do see how that's beneficial. Yeah. And I hate to play kind of whack-a-mole with the questions, but as one answers, I think of another question. So thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Santos, just one more question. So on some lines that are recorded, the public gets the public number and it's the recorded line, but then some of the offices still have like the direct line. Will that still be an option, or will these identified lines only have this recorded line, or will there still be kind of the direct line into like desks and offices and things?
The direct lines into each department are virtual lines. They're programmed into the system. They don't actually have a physical place. When you pick up the extension, if you dial 7123 Mayor's office, mm-hmm. when you pick up an inside extension, it moves the call over. So it's virtual into the department, but it's going to be hardwired to the customer service extensions.
Right. No, I mean to bypass that whole system. Like for instance, there was some not my office, but some offices you can bypass the recorded line and go straight to a supervisor or somebody else. You can do that. Is that what we're going to be able to have now?
Yes. So.
Okay. So there'll be like a desk line and
yes.
then the recorded public line.
It only records specific.
Right. Specific lines are recorded. The customer service lines are hardwired to be recorded.
Okay. Okay. Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Azak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Part of my question was answered, of which. Who was going to be recorded. But the other part is the school system. I couldn't remember if this was mentioned during the IT meeting. Is the school system part of this or just City Hall?
No, just City Hall.
Just City Hall. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Beauregard.
I just wanted to move this favorably. I think it's a great idea.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended to full city council. Item number eight.
Order appropriation of $425,692 from Executive Office of Public Safety and Securities, FY16 Senator Charles E. Shannon Community Safety Initiative Grant. To Brockton Police Department, FY16 Senator Charles E. Shannon Community Safety Initiative Grant Fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, John Crowley, Police Chief.
Evening, Chief.
Good evening, Councilman.
Did you get here?
Just walked in.
We do this every year. I move it favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Item number nine.
Order appropriation of $118,246 from U.S. Department of Justice, FY15 Justice Assistant Grant. To Brockton Police Department, U.S. Department of Justice, FY15 Justice Assistance Grant Fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, John Crowley, Police Chief.
Move to recommend favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably full city council. Item number, thank you, Chief. You have one more.
Yes, sir.
Item number 11.
Order appropriation of $45,000 from FY2016 Massachusetts Department of Public Health Naloxone Grant. To Brockton Police Department, FY2016 Massachusetts Department of Public Health Naloxone Grant Fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, John Crowley, Police Chief.
Move in favor.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably.
Just quick on the motion, I just have one question.
We have a question, Councilor Ranieri.
Chief, realizing you know what this is for and what we've had to use it for in the past, naturally, has that gone down? I mean, the numbers in regards to this gone down somewhat from what it was, say, a couple months ago, or are we still?
We're still fighting the fight.
We're still fighting the fight. Okay.
And just for a point of knowledge, this grant is split between the police and the fire department. They will get half. So they'll be able to supply their firefighters.
Okay. But I mean, we're still, but it, okay. It's doing what it has to do. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Item number 12.
Order appropriation of $2,200 from Commonwealth of Massachusetts Emergency Management Agency FY15-16 HMEP Grant to BEMA HMEP Grant Fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Stephen Hook, Jr., Director.
Move favorable.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Just before we take the vote, I did receive a call from Mr. Hook. He's unavailable this evening.
Okay, makes sense.
All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Item number 14.
Resolve that Massasoit Community College President Charlie Wall be invited to come before the Finance Committee to discuss options to bring the Massasoit Allied Health and Sciences Building back to its originally proposed location in downtown Brockton. Invited Dr. Charlie Wall, President.
Good evening. Before you make your motion, Councilor, I am in receipt of a letter from Dr. Wall that he asked me to read this evening. Dear Mr. Cruz, I am in receipt of your invitation, which arrived late Friday on Friday, April 1st, to appear before the Standing Committee on Finance to discuss the Massasoit Community College Allied Health Building. While I am not able to attend, I would ask that you please read the following statement into the minutes at this evening's meeting. As I have said publicly numerous times since the project to renovate the Ganley Building to house the originally envisioned Downtown Brockton Higher Education Collaborative was canceled by the Commonwealth through its Division of Capital Asset Maintenance and Management, DCAM, Massasoit Community College remains committed with its partners to creating a higher education presence in downtown Brockton to offer focused and relevant academic programming. While unlikely that we would get funding for such an effort on the previously projected scale, we might be successful in securing sufficient monies to move forward with a re-envisioned version of that collaborative. I would be happy to once again offer leadership with the higher education partners in re-engaged conversations with the city to bring that project to fruition. I welcome and invite conversation with members of the City Council about the ways Massasoit Community College can continue to partner with the city to the benefit of the community, the service region, the institution, and the students we serve across the Commonwealth. I am also happy to clarify and discuss the historical and logistical details of the planning processes that have led us to the siting of the Massasoit Community College's long-planned Allied Health Building on the Brockton campus. Sincerely, Charles Wall, Ph.D., President.
And I reinstate my motion, as Councilor Monahan is not here, and I'm sure he probably would want to give Dr. Wall another chance if he's willing to come. I ask that we postpone this to the next Finance Committee meeting on his behalf.
Second?
Second.
Motion made and seconded to postpone to the next Finance meeting. All those in favor? All those opposed? And I would ask you, Madam Clerk, could you possibly get that letter out tomorrow so that he can't complain it just got to him late? Item number 15.
Resolved that the mayor or his designee, the collector treasurer, and the city solicitor or his designee be invited to appear before a committee of the city council to update council members on the status of the Whitman dispute and efforts to obtain payment. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Martin Brophy, collector treasurer, Philip C. Nazarella, and or his designee solicitor.
Councilor Farwell, just so you know, I have been informed that we'll have to have a fairly broad conversation on this.
Yes.
Because it does involve possible litigation. So, Councilor Farwell.
Mr. Condon, just by researching some information, I found out that apparently there's a dispute over about $870,000 or $890,000 that Whitman claims is an excessive charge for sewer. I don't want to get into the, shall we say, all of the salient facts tonight, because I'm sensitive to the fact that the law department is negotiating and discussing this issue with Whitman. I'm more concerned with the fact that it seems like no good deed goes unpunished. Brockton is a good neighbor. We do what we're supposed to do, and then it always seems like we're coming out on somewhat of the short end of the stick. And I just didn't want this to drag on for years, but I'm apprised of the fact that apparently there are ongoing negotiations. I don't know if you or the solicitor want to comment.
In a general sense, I can give you some
assurances. Just in a general sense, yes.
First of all, the dispute has to do with applicability of contract provisions and what we have and haven't billed. So it's not as if they're simply trying to take advantage of us. And there have been good faith discussions to try to resolve it. And in fact, we just got a payment of $400,000 toward the $870,000 or $90,000 bill. So that just came in. So we are making progress. I think we're probably pretty close to reaching a resolution over the disputed items. And there's a second issue which has to do with a new contract for them. And the new contract would have to come to City Council for review and approval in any case. So my basic message is there was a dispute. It's taken a while, but we're getting close to a full resolution. The $400,000 I don't think will be the final payment against that $892,000. It's just a good faith payment. And I think not too long from now we'll be in front of you saying we've resolved the old issues, we've been paid, and here is a contract for your approval for a new contract for Whitman.
Well, my apology to councilors who probably are tired of hearing me always bring up financial issues, but it's unfortunately it's the times that Mr. Condon and I went through years ago. So having heard this information tonight, I think I'd like to postpone this until second Finance Committee meeting in May, when perhaps we'll have an update on the issue from the solicitor and from Mr. Condon, because I don't think we're really going to be able to get into the details tonight.
Second.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to postpone until the second Finance Committee meeting in May. All those in favor? Opposed? So moved. I believe the way we've jumped around, I think we hit everything, Councilor. Is there anybody else still out there that we haven't called up yet? Officer, you don't have anything with us tonight? Any moments of personal privilege? We're adjourned.
Thank you.
There you go.